Hello and welcome to the Center for European Studies. On behalf of the Center and the European Union Study Group, I would like to welcome you all to this talk, The Refugee Crisis and the Disuniting of the Union, Europe on the Brink. Our speaker today is Shayla Benhabib, who is a professor, who is Eugene Meyer Professor of Political Science and Philosophy at Yale University. She has received numerous prizes, awards, and recognitions, which I will not attempt to list. Shayla Benhabib is one of the leading critical theorists and discourse theorists today. She has written extensively on the history of critical theory, on issues of migration, cosmopolitanism, international law, and she is currently working on a number of new projects, a new project on the new sovereigntism, and currently has an edited volume towards a new democratic imaginary, which is an edited volume, a collection of essays from the Istanbul seminars that are held every summer. And I would like to highlight in particular some of her work on migration, particularly The Right to Have Rights and Dignity in Adversity, are two notable books that she has written that are examining the rights of migrants, the plight of migrants, and from a very theoretical perspective. And unfortunately, those books and her interest, which predated the migrant crisis, have become almost prescient and very relevant for the world today. So I think as we try to think through and understand the migrant crisis and its implications both for Europe and the world, I can hardly think of anybody better to speak on these topics than Shayla Benhabib. Please join me in welcoming her.
It's a pleasure to be back at Harvard. I am not a new person to these institutions, to these rooms, as many of you in this room know. I had the honor of being on the faculty for a period of nearly cumulative 10 years. So I see a lot of my former students also and friends here. So welcome. I want to recall the memory of Stanley Hoffman in this lecture. Stanley was my senior colleague, and for a while, for about 7 years, we were neighbors. And as some of you know, many of you know, Stanley and his mother were refugees in France. And I'm not going to say that I'm dedicating this lecture to his memory because I'm not sure that it's worth that, but at least I'd like to recall his memory because I was not able to attend the services. On February 16th, 2014, nearly 2 years ago now, the New York Times Magazine ran an article by a journalist by the name of Mac McClelland called Container City. Container City refers to the Kilis refugee camp in southern Turkey, at the time housing 14,000 people from Syria. Protected by high gates and surrounded by barbed wire, Kilis from the outside shares many features with refugee camps all over the world that make them indistinguishable from prisons or criminal detention centers. Kilis houses its population in 2,053 identical containers spread in neat rows. The pictures that accompany the article remind one of shipping containers at a harbor. I was hoping to have them with me, but I'm sorry, I wasn't able to pull them from the internet, but they're there. Each container is a 23 by 10 foot trailer with 3 rooms, a bathroom with its own plumbing and hot water, a kitchen, equipped with a refrigerator and a stove, and a living room with a color TV that receives close to 1,000 channels, probably picking up programs from all over the Mediterranean. But despite all this, quote, nobody likes living here. It is hard for us, said Bashir Alito, the section leader who was so effusive in his praise for the camps and his Turkish hosts. Quote, inside we are unhappy. In my heart, it's temporary, not permanent. And no quote, many of Turkey's so-called urban refugees, hailing from Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, who knows where else, live at large in cities in often as undocumented migrants and refuse to be placed in the camps, preferring to face street violence and economic hardship rather than be cooped up in camps. This may be because, as Kemal Kirishci, a Turkish social scientist, observed, the refugees are recognizing that they are there to stay and don't want to risk living in the camps, end of quote. As I mentioned, this article appeared 2 years ago, but it feels as if decades have passed since then. Container City, which at the time seemed like an advertisement for the newest technologies in refugee management and organization, and almost a goodwill message from the Turkish government to the international community, has now receded into the background. Foremost in the public's consciousness is the exponential growth of violence on Turkey's long border with Syria. With the entry of Russia into the civil war in Syria, new waves of refugees have been created since the summer of 2016. Seared into our memories, undoubtedly, is the young boy Aylan Kurdi, 3 years old, lying prostrate on the beach of the Turkish shores of the Aegean with his little sneakers lying next to him. It is important to step back, though, for a moment from these truly painful events and to look at the big picture unfolding in Europe, Turkey, and the MENA region from the vantage point of the question of refugees and statelessness. The Kilis refugee camp is one among dozens in other countries of the world. A report by the United Nations High Commissioner of Refugees notes that by the end of 2014, the number of worldwide refugees stood at 59.5 million. This was 8.3 million more than the year before. And with no end to sight in conflicts in places such as Syria, the Central African Republic, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo, among others, the number at the end of 2016 stands at something like 65 million. As the number of refugees worldwide has increased, not only has the number of camps grown, but the camps have ceased to be places where one held people temporarily. Rather, the camps have become semi-permanent. The largest refugee camp in the world, Kenya's Dadaab, is 20 years old and houses 420,000 refugees. The Palestinian refugee camps in southern Lebanon are in many cases nearly 70 to 50 years old, depending on whether the refugee population was created in 1948 or 1968. The refugees who live in these camps, and in some cases who have spent their entire lives there and have known no other context, become PRSs, those in so-called protracted refugee situation. For the first time, Turkey has become the largest refugee hosting country worldwide with 2.2 million currently. Turkey is followed by Pakistan with 1.51 million, Lebanon 1.15 million, the Islamic Republic of Iran 982,000, Ethiopia 660,000, and Jordan 654,000. I take these figures from the United Nations High Commissioner websites that are available. And maybe just keep these numbers in mind when we come to talk about Europe, which so far has only accepted barely 1.1 million. It's always the southern and the poorer countries of the world that accept the largest number of refugees and carry the burden, so that's one. Refugees, asylees, IDPs, internally displaced persons, PRSs, those who are in protected refugee situation, stateless persons are new categories of human beings created by an international system in turmoil and are subject to a special kind of precarious existence. Although they share with other suffering strangers the status of victimhood and become the objects of our compassion, or as the UNHCR HCR puts it, they become persons of concern. Their plight reveals the most fateful disjunction between so-called human rights, or the rights of man in the older locution, and the rights of the citizen. Between the universal claims to human dignity and the specificities of indignity suffered by those who possess only human rights and are thrown outside the bounds of their polity for numerous reasons. Since its inception in 1948, the post-World War II state system has been afflicted with this fundamental paradox. The principle upheld by nearly all state constitutions that human beings are entitled to certain fundamental rights in virtue of their humanity, yet the equal assertion of state sovereignty, which subjects the respect for and protection of these rights to being a member of a sovereign political entity. Refugees and war and asylum are not new phenomena in human history. They have existed in biblical times. What is new is the architectonic of the state system in the post-World War II system, a period that just exacerbates this conflict because its acknowledgement, which I will explain in more detail when I go on, of universal human rights on the one hand and sovereignty, state sovereignty on the other, creating a new sovereignty regime. Human rights remain the rights of those who are protected by a sovereign polity recognized by the international system. Those whose sovereign protection fails for reasons of civil war, internal coups, ethnic warfare, increasingly maybe climate change or economic collapse, become refugees, asylum seekers, internally displaced persons, or PRSs. They become a new category of human beings, though their language and their dreams, their bodies, and their culture do not change. What changes is their civic identity in the world of states. Hannah Arendt called them les apatrides, the stateless, and from her famous discussion of the right to have rights in the origins of totalitarianism to Giorgio Agamben's Homo Sacer, to Judith Butler's concept of precarious lives, and Jacques Rancière's call to the enactment of rights, the asylum seeker, the stateless, and the refugee have become metaphors as well as symptoms of a much deeper malaise in the politics of the system of states in late modernity. Emerging out of the ashes of World War II and with the memories of the Holocaust and the destruction of the Europe's old order very much still present, the European Union, first conceived as a coal and steel community, then a common market, has now become a new kind of polity in human history, encompassing 28 states with a population of 508 million. Combining supranational with intergovernmental modes of organization and governance, the EU has brought many novelties to the stage of world politics. Aiming at the free movement of peoples, goods, services, and capital, 22 of the 28 member countries had until recently abolished internal border controls, referred to as the Schengen area, while the UK and Ireland remained opt-outs with the expectation that Bulgaria, Croatia, Cyprus, and Romania would eventually join the Schengen area, but Schengen is disappearing just as we speak. Since the Maastricht Treaty of 1993, the EU has also created European Union citizenship for the citizens of member countries. There is still, however, no common policy of access to citizenship and naturalization in the EU for so-called third country nationals. There are many directives, and there have been many directives to harmonize the rights and status of third country nationals and those of long or short-term residents. For this group of individuals, in effect, there is no free movement within the EU with the right to resettle and change country of residence, except, of course, through market mobility and family unification purposes. And although the promise of European Union citizenship was to be accompanied by an equal bundle of entitlements to socioeconomic rights, this has not been achieved either. Furthermore, even the free mobility of EU citizens themselves, leave alone third country nationals, such as Turks, Afghanis, you know, even Americans, even the free mobility of EU citizens themselves to settle across the border in all 28 member countries and to take up a job or residency is in question. Particularly when the EU enlargement process brought many East Central European countries, such as Hungary, Poland, Slovenia, the Czech and Slovak republics into the EU, the mobility rights of these citizens were restricted for certain periods of time so as not to flood the more lucrative German, UK, French, Italian, and other markets. Today, one of the major bones of contention in the negotiations around the Brexit, the exit of the United Kingdom from the EU, is the UK's refusal to pay certain social benefits to those who accept jobs in the UK, such as, for example, children allowances. The many promises of EU citizenship have not been fulfilled. Now, sociologically, citizenship entails three dimensions. Political rights and privileges to elect and stand for public office, a bundle of social rights and entitlements, and a shared collective identity around commonalities of language, ethnicity, religion, and the like. Each of these dimensions of citizenship, political rights and privileges, social entitlements, collective identity, is historically contested, and their current form in any given polity is testimony to the sedimented history of struggles, compromises, defeats, as well as triumphs among contesting groups. There is not and cannot be citizenship that is uncontested along these multiple dimensions. In several works in the last decade and a half, such as The Rights of Others and Other Cosmopolitanism, and in a volume I co-edited with Judith Resnick called Migrations and Mobilities, Gender, Borders, and Citizenship, I have introduced the concept of disaggregation of citizenship to examine the unbundling and rebundling of these dimensions of citizenship. Who has rights to which entitlements in virtue of which criteria or identity marker? This is the crucial question, not just in Europe, but I think all over the world, although my case studies were limited to Europe at the time. Considered with this analytical framework in mind, it seemed as if the European Union was the harbinger of a new cosmopolitan form of citizenship. The free movements of people across borders would be guaranteed, and the citizen would be identified not by being the subject automatically of a sovereign national polity, but through free and elected commitment to another community, be it the city or the region, if he or she so wished. Citywide citizenship or regional citizenship emerged as options. European Union citizens would acquire the right to vote for and stand for office in most municipal and regional elections in their host countries. And of course, they could vote in EU parliamentary elections, which is still the case. But they could only vote in the elections of their countries of origin if they were to return to them. Expatriate voting is in general discouraged. Such EU citizens would be cosmopolitans, not in the sense of having no country at all, but in the sense of having multiple allegiances, which somehow, it was hoped, would crystallize into a sense of supra or transnational EU citizenship. I believe that it is too early to say whether this project has completely failed. Among the younger European generation, despite all the institutional difficulties of Maastricht citizenship, among the younger European generation in particular, there is the strong presence of bi as well as transnational European identities. But as we all know, at the present, we are confronted with the rise of nationalist, racist, and xenophobic movements throughout Europe. From the start, though, let us note that the free mobility of goods, services, and capital and the free mobility of persons were never commensurable and could not be. Whereas many EU member countries actively encouraged the free movement of goods, services, and capital, they jealously guarded the free movement of persons. Market freedoms and cosmopolitan freedoms at times aided one another and at other times blocked each other. The protection of the market freedoms, the continuing administrative and bureaucratic integration of the EU, however, have created an extraordinary thicket of legal regimes which overlap, cooperate, as well as compete with one another. The European Court of Justice, which bears the primary responsibility for safeguarding the Treaty on the Establishment of the European Union, operates alongside the European Court of Human Rights, which is a juridical regime to which 47 countries in total have acceded, 19 of which are not members of the European Union. Among them, most importantly, Russia and Turkey, for whom actually the European Court of Human Rights almost functions as a surrogate constitutional court. The interplay between these two courts, as well as the pushback they receive for certain decisions from strong constitutional courts such as the Bundesverfassungsgericht, the Italian court, as well as the direct effect implications of the European community law on individual countries. I'm not going into detail here, but we can discuss this during the discussion if you wish. All these have been the site of high-stakes juridical and political dramas in recent years. Instead of cosmopolitan citizenship, I want to suggest what the EU has managed to create is a highly regulated and protected legal personality. This abstract bearer of EU rights and privileges is not identical with the active citizen of the demos, though legal personality is a necessary but insufficient condition of true citizenship. The current refugee crisis is in the first place about access to such legal personality, the right to be considered as a person in the eyes of the law. Access, in Hannah Arendt's words, to the right to have rights. Now I come to Hannah Arendt. Throughout this lecture, I'm going to go back and forth between theory and policy. I hope I'm not losing everybody, but I've decided to compose it in that way. The following words of Hannah Arendt have often been recalled in the context of these discussions. Quote, she wrote, "We become aware of the existence of a right to have rights, and that means to be to live in a framework where one is judged by one's actions and opinions, and a right to belong to some kind of organized community, only when millions of people emerged who had lost and could not regain these rights because of the new global political situation." She continued, "The right that corresponds to this loss and that was never even mentioned among the human rights cannot be expressed in the categories of the 18th century because they presumed that rights spring immediately from the nature of man. The right to have rights or the right of every individual to belong to humanity should be guaranteed by humanity itself. It is by no means certain whether this is possible," she concludes. The right to have rights has thus become the well-known phrase through which to capture the plight of the stateless, the refugee, the asylee, and the displaced person, that is, the plight of those who have been cast out of the framework, in Arendt's words, where one is judged by one's actions and opinions alone. Tomorrow in Professor Peter Gordon's seminar on Hannah Arendt, I will be discussing the more philosophical aspects of this passage, but let me focus here simply on the meaning of the right to have rights for today's refugees seeking admission to the EU and not only for them. Since Hannah Arendt penned her discussion of the right to have rights in 1951, international institutions and international law have changed the landscape against the background of which she wrote the right to have rights in the origins. Thus, the Universal Human Rights Declaration in Articles 13, 14, and 15 address some of these questions. Article 13 reads, I'm quoting, everyone has the right to freedom of movement and residence within the borders of each state. Everyone has the right to leave any country, including his own, and return to his country, meaning there is a right to immigration, but of course there is no symmetrical right to immigration. No country is obliged under international law to accept you as an immigrant, except under conditions of asylum. Article 14 now encodes the right of asylum. Everyone has the right to seek and to enjoy in other countries asylum from persecution. But this right may not be invoked in the cases of prosecutions generally arising from non-political crimes or from acts contrary to the purposes and principles of the United Nations. In simpler language, if you are a war criminal, you cannot invoke, or an ordinary criminal, you cannot invoke the right of asylum. Article 15 seeks guarantees against denaturalization or loss of citizenship. It says everyone has the right to a nationality, and no one shall be arbitrarily deprived of his nationality or denied the right to change his nationality. Together with the United Nations Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide of 1948, the 1951 Geneva Conventions on the Status of Refugees, and in particular the two major international human rights covenants, such as the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, these documents and the institutions of compliance and monitoring they have created have altered the legal landscape for the entitlement to and exercise of the right to have rights. Arendt's formula, therefore, needs to be considered in the light of international human rights theory and practice. Article 15 of the UDHR, which states that denaturalization and rendering human beings stateless is a violation of international human rights, is in complete agreement with Arendt's discussion. The obverse side of denaturalization is naturalization, or gaining access to citizenship or to some kind of permanent membership or residency in a polity. There is no such human right in any of the international covenants, although there are many provisions against denaturalization, that is to say, granting citizenship or the right to citizenship remains still a sovereign privilege. I actually, in my book on the rights of others, suggested that one could formulate a human right to membership or citizenship under certain conditions, but I don't see any reason as to why we shouldn't push the law further than where it has gone now. In addition to the UDHR articles which I cited above, the condition of refugees and displaced persons is governed by the 1951 Geneva Conventions and the 1967 Protocols. Increasingly, it is observed that the 1951 Convention is inadequate for dealing with today's refugee issues because it appears to have been modeled on the definition of the refugee as the dissident or the prisoner of conscience. So this is an important point to keep in mind. Article 1 of the Convention, as amended by the 1967 Protocol, defines a refugee as, quote, a person who, owing to a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership of a particular social group, or political opinion, is outside the country of his nationality and is unable or owing to such fear unwilling to avail himself for the protection of that country, or who, not having a nationality and being outside the country of his former residence, is unable or unwilling to return to it. Within the European context, all these international agreements, the Refugee Convention, now are compounded by yet another level of regulation having to do with the so-called Dublin agreements. I'm sorry, this is a very complicated legal landscape. And as Americans, we are often very ignorant about what's happening in Europe and how Europe is tying itself in knots about this problem, partially as a consequence of all these provisions and treaties which were developed and articulated with the best of intentions. The member state, the Dublin Agreement, according to the Dublin Agreement, the member state through which the refugee first enters the EU territory is supposed to identify and register him or her in order to avoid repeated demands of asylum. The Dublin Agreements were articulated in a period when refugees were gaming the system by placing applications in Greece, then they would go to Holland, then they would go to France, et cetera. This was referred to as refugees in orbit. Yeah? Now, until Angela Merkel's decision to accept Syrian refugees en masse this summer, whose application would then be processed in Germany, first countries of entry alone were responsible for processing their application, a process that, if done conscientiously, could take up to 2 years. Okay? If you want to really live up to all the international protections and so on, which are very good, but imagine the kind of administrative and legal knowledge, the knowledge of background and languages that you need to have to be able to start processing these refugee applications. Okay? So the system never made any sense because it put the whole legal burden for processing such applications on states such as Greece, Italy, Spain, I mean, the Mediterranean, basically, right? That could be accessed. And until this procedure is completed, the asylum seekers and refugees could not legally enter the European Union territory. The land route for refugees to reach the European Union borders over the Balkans now has become much more dangerous and nearly impossible, with Hungary building a fence around itself and a wall going up between Greece and Macedonia. And we're beginning to see the pictures of refugees at this wall. Now, let me say something about Turkey. Not being a member of the European Union, but still respecting the Geneva Conventions, as well as being a member of the European Convention on Human Rights, Turkey plays by different rules than EU countries. Technically, Turkey is not a first country of entry into the European Union. It stands under no obligation to be the first to process asylum requests from refugees. It is also under no obligation not to let them travel to Europe. It can serve, quote unquote, as a safe country of passage. Now, precisely for this reason, Chancellor Angela Merkel and the European Union are offering Turkey a package of 3 billion euros in aid for refugee settlement and absorption. Somebody from the UN with whom I was discussing some of these issues told me that the total budget for chocolate consumption in the EU is 3 billion annually. So the estimate of those who are in a position to know is that what is needed for this effort is something between 40 to 50 billion per annum, not the 3 billion that's being offered to Turkey. So domestic as well as EU-wide considerations are leading the EU to ask for Turkey's help. And in the process, one more time, the carrot of visa-free travel for Turkish citizens and reopening the negotiations of Turkey's EU membership is being dangled in front of the Turkish government. Now, politically, we all know from reading the newspapers that 11 countries now have abdicated the Schengen, referred to as the revival of the old Habsburg Empire, Austria and the Balkan countries. Mrs. Merkel is under tremendous pressure. There are regional elections in Germany on March 7th. And unless she can show that the outcome of the negotiations with Turkey is going to end up in the reduction of the number of refugees coming into the EU, it is very likely that her political capital, which is spent, will be even further spent. From a legal point of view, what is happening right now is that Germany has single-handedly abdicated the Dublin Convention. And that is not necessarily a bad thing because the Dublin Convention made no sense. But what is not happening is that if the Dublin Convention made no sense, that is, if it made no sense to just burden the Mediterranean countries of the EU with the process, with the obligation to process refugee application, why are there no airlifts? Yeah? In other words, once the refugees are registered in Turkey, and that has all sorts of curlicues that I'll mention in a minute, why aren't they being airlifted directly to Germany if Germany is willing to accept them? I think the answer is politically that Mrs. Merkel would have a revolt in her hands. I think that the German population is willing to go along with their obligation under the right of asylum, and we know that this is, for Germany, it has become a very emotional kind of reenactment of World War II drama. It's like expiating for a sin again that they will not commit it again, and I respect that. But the situation is absurd. If, in fact, Dublin no longer makes sense, if Germany is willing to accept these refugees, airlift them, or put them into NATO ships instead of these dingies and pirate ships that are leading to death, and relieve the burden on Greece, because Greece is tittering on the brink of disaster. Not only is the Greek economy, from everything that we know, still not quite recovered, but the burden of processing all these refugees, there are about 150,000 right now, is quite unbearable. So the European Union has really created in some ways its own worst enemy. It's created its own dilemmas. But I want to return one more time to some of the theoretical questions, deeper philosophical questions suggested by the condition of refugees and asylum seekers. In an article called "Who is the Subject of the Rights of Men?", Jacques Rancière, the French political theorist, subjected Hannah Arendt's famous discussion to a trenchant critique. Composed in 2004, after the US invasion of Iraq had taken place and the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq were at their height, Rancière begins by noting how the rights of men, or in contemporary language, human rights, which were rejuvenated by the dissident movements of Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, became transformed, he argues, in the first decade of the 21st century, quote, into the rights of the rightless, of the populations hunted out of their homes and land and threatened by ethnic slaughter. They appeared more and more as the rights of the victims, the rights of those who were unable to enact any rights or even any claims in their name, so that eventually their rights had to be upheld by others, he continues, at the cost of shattering the edifice of international rights in the name, according to Rancière, of a new right to humanitarian interference, which ultimately boiled down to the right of invasion. He's referring here to R2P as the right of humanitarian interference. Human rights, the rights of the rightless, became the ideological scaffolding for humanitarian reason at best and for humanitarian intervention at worst. It is hard not to agree with at least some of these reflections of Rancière's in view of the worsening refugee crisis and the hypocrisy of the language of human rights. But what is Rancière's critique of Arendt? Often it is hard to distinguish between his understanding of what Hannah Arendt said and the way Arendt's words have been deployed by others such as Giorgio Agamben. Commenting on Agamben's claim, quote, that the camp can be interpreted as the nomos, the law of modernity, Rancière notes that refugee camps, the zones where illegal migrants are parked by national authorities, such as Melilla in Spain or Lampedusa in Italy, can all be subsumed under the sweeping logic of modern sovereignty exercising, quote unquote, in the fashionable language, biopower. I want to say this analysis is in the night in which all cows are black, to use a famous Hegelian locution. That is a mode of thinking for which all relevant distinctions disappear. Unlike Arendt, who separated carefully the unique logic of totalitarianism from that of modern mass democracies and many other regime forms such as tyranny and despotism, the camps appear in this analysis as the culmination, quote unquote, of a logic of biopower intrinsic to modernity. This is Agamben, perhaps Sigmund Bauman, and upon a contentious reading, maybe even the dialectic of enlightenment can be said to fit this interpretation, but it's not Arendt. Rancière at times differentiates between Arendt and Agamben, and at other times he seems to suggest that Agamben's misreading of Arendt is justified on the basis of her own confusions. Rancière's main disagreement with Arendt centers around the question of democracy. He claims that Arendt's diagnosis of the paradoxes of the rights of man actually amounts to a critique of democracy, a very strange conclusion. Having identified the rights of man with the rights of the idiotes, he argues, or the private individual, Arendt on Rancière's reading cannot see that the essence of democracy is challenging between the boundary between the private and the public. Instead, he claims she essentializes the public and private distinction. And in a critical sleight of hand, Rancière claims that in Arendt's account, quote, the stateless, the refugee, and the asylum seeker are equated with the private, poor, unpoliticized individual. Yet Arendt's point is precisely that the poor, the private, and unpoliticized individuals still belong to a polity. Recall here her supremely ironic comment that even prisoners had more rights than the stateless. Why is Rancière so obviously misreading Arendt? And I do hope to come back to the EU crisis eventually. Bear with me. Primarily because he wants to fit Arendt's position into the scheme of what he calls the archi-political, which he understands as, quote, depoliticizing matters of power and repression and setting them in a sphere of exceptionality that is no longer political, in an anthropological sphere of sacrality situated beyond the reach of the senses. This then unfolds into the critique of Arendt's distinction between the private and the public realms, and ultimately of her wanting to separate technology and economics from politics. Now, I admit with Rancière that Arendt's views on the relationship between the public and the private spheres and of economics, technology, and politics are problematic. And I dare say many of us who believe in the art of more careful reading, such as Richard Bernstein, Albert Wellmer, Hannah Pitkin, and others, have subjected these aspects of Arendt's thought to a clearer critique than Rancière himself. But why am I bothering with Rancière, apart from the fact that he has a lot of influence and is an interesting thinker? There is something in his restatement about the paradox of human rights which I want to single out. He says that the paradox of human rights is that one seems least in possession of them when one is merely human. And he agrees here with Arendt. He writes in a typically French twister, quote, the rights of men are the rights of those who have not the rights that they have and have the rights that they have not. One more time. The rights of men are the rights of those who have not the rights that they have and have the rights that they have not. What does this mean? The subject of rights are those who engage in a process of subjectivization or enactment of rights, that is, those who take it upon themselves to claim their rights, such as to bridge the two sides of this equation. The first half of this paradox, the rights of men are the rights of those who have not the rights that they have, is concretized by Rancière with respect to Olympe de Gouges, the aristocratic woman who sided with the revolution, but who was guillotined by the Jacobins for participating in the male sphere of citizenship and questioning the place of the woman mother citizen ideal that the revolutionaries had devised under the influence of Rousseau's regressive theory of gender roles. Olympe de Gouges exercised the human rights which the Declaration proclaimed that she had, namely to be a citizen, but which she was not entitled to exercise because she was a woman. And when she did so and engaged in the public sphere, she became the subject of rights which she did not have, i.e. that of participation, which was closed off to her. For this transgression, she was guillotined. There is something powerful in Rancière's formula, and I want to suggest that this may be a helpful way of thinking about the disjunction or the décalage between transnational human rights, which I have outlined above, and the rights of asylees and refugees. To do so, let us move back one more time from text to context, from conceptual analysis to an outline of institutional and legal developments. Rancière's formula, the rights of men are the rights of those who have the rights they have not, can be parsed in light of contemporary human rights law. With the advent of international human rights law, individuals are recognized as holding human rights directly under international law. But what does this mean? It means, in the first place, that the civil and political rights of citizens, as codified in various constitutions and bills of rights, can themselves be criticized in light of internationally acknowledged human rights standards, as transnational women's movements, movements for indigenous people's rights, the movement to abolish death penalty show. Particularly, the transnational women's movement across the globe have used CEDAW to force their governments and public institutions to comply with the convention standards of equal pay for equal work, against sexual harassment, sexual discrimination, and for consideration of women's special health and physical needs. Other examples can be drawn from social struggles and litigations made possible by the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights in enabling indigenous groups' struggles for their own territories and cultural patrimony in the global south. An intense debate, as some of you know, is now raging in the United Kingdom since the UK acceded to the European Charter of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms about prisoners' disenfranchisement or loss of voting rights, which was ruled against by the European Court of Human Rights repeatedly, the so-called Hearst versus UK case. In all these instances, international human rights instruments have created a conceptual and normative space within which a jurisgenerative struggle is taking place between international human rights and institutionalized civil and political rights. By jurisgenerativity, which was a concept first developed by Robert Post and then Frank Michelman, myself, and others, I mean the following. Laws acquire meaning in that they are interpreted within the context of rules and significations, which often they cannot control. There can be no rules without interpretation, as we know since Wittgenstein. Rules can only be followed insofar as they are interpreted. But there are also no rules, including legal norms, which can control the varieties of interpretation that it can be subject to within all different hermeneutical contexts. Law's normativity does not consist in the grounds of its formal validity, legality alone. Law can also structure an extra-legal normative universe by developing new vocabularies for public claim-making, by encouraging new forms of subjectivity to engage with the public sphere, and by interjecting existing relations of power with forms of justice to come Avenir in Derrida's terms. Law is not simply a method of coercion and an instrument of domination or the silencing of dissent. Undoubtedly, it is also such an instrument and such a medium. But the disjunction between the facticity and the validity of law is the space into which a politics of juris generativity can be inserted, which both signals to the presence of this gap and tries to bridge it in the name of future forms of justice to come. I'm nearing a conclusion, I have a few more pages. How can we reread the right to have rights in view of these considerations then? International human rights norm since 1948, as I have emphasized, has created norms, instruments, and institutions through which states' treatment of not only of their own nationals, but of non-nationals, documented and undocumented migrants, refugees, asylum seekers, and the stateless can be framed, debated, litigated, and contested. It is in this domain still that sovereign privilege tries to protect its most brutal form. And we witness what Didier Fassin, who was one of the chief officers of Médecins Sans Frontières, has called the ironies of humanitarian reason. He writes, humanitarian reason governs precarious lives, the lives of the unemployed and the asylum seeker, the lives of sick immigrants and people with AIDS, the lives of disaster victims and victims of conflict, threatened and forgotten lives that humanitarian government brings into existence by protecting and revealing them. Yet, as Fassin, who is by no means a cynic about this, by the way, also notes, sometimes there are legal victories that oblige recipient states to grant undocumented or illegal migrants with AIDS the rights to stay. At other times, even the parent of an American child who remains without parental supervision, if the parent is deported, is indeed put outside the borders of the United States. Sometimes the application of a refugee for asylum is denied after 10 years. In the meantime, this person has married and has integrated into the civil society of the country in which she is illegally in residence. In many cases, she's summarily deported to a country of origin and a life which she has never known. In other cases, as in the Netherlands, for example, humanitarian reason is exercised through a process called dulden, roughly patience or tolerance, such as to enable those undocumented migrants to disappear into the folds of civil society and live below the radar of legality. As political fatigue about internationalism has gripped the US in the wake of the interventions in Afghanistan and Iraq, and President Obama's politics of coercion in Syria has created moral quagmires, we have moved from the right to have rights to the critique of humanitarian reason. Humanitarianism is a necessary yet wholly insufficient response to these dilemmas. The major legal instruments created to deal with the transborder movements of peoples, which I have outlined, themselves presuppose also a series of problematic distinctions as between economic versus convention refugees, the individual claimant for asylum versus asylees originating from regions of generalized conflict. In other words, we are in a situation where, as a result of the worldwide movement of peoples, even these major legal instruments themselves are being forced, and some of the distinctions are no longer as useful as they once were. The worst danger that refugees and asylum seekers can suffer from is being forgotten by the world. It is only when the lights are dimmed and world public opinion is tired and looks elsewhere that rapes and murders in camps take place. People disappear in the middle of the night, are deported, robbed, or maimed. Hannah Arendt referred to the halls of oblivion that the 20th century had created with the establishment of camps. The danger for refugees today is that at any moment in time, they may slide into these halls of oblivion and it is then that their rights to have rights will be forgotten. Unfortunately, we are traversing a moment of such danger in the European Union and also, I'm afraid, in some worldwide developments at present, though the level of militancy and resilience on the part of the refugees who are enacting their right to have rights indicates that at least some of them are determined the status and dignity of legal personhood. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. We have about 45 minutes for Q&A. Unfortunately, we have to finish by 6 o'clock so that the building can close. But I would ask you all to raise your hands. We have some microphones that will travel around so that we can all hear your questions. And I assume that there will be quite a bit of interest, so please keep your questions short so that we can have as much discussion as possible.
Hi, I'm Archie. I'm a student of your student. How do you think that the union will progress regarding intra-country sovereignty? So I'm thinking particularly the infringement on Greece's sovereign powers by Germany. How do you think that's going to progress?
You mean not just with respect to the refugee question, but you also mean with respect to questions of economics? Well, a lot will really depend on the outcome of the German elections wanted. I mean, just to speak in terms of Tagespolitik, day-to-day politics, Schäuble clearly has a much more strident view about what Greece to do in order to stand in the Union. And this probably reflects a broader division within the economic alternatives of the Union. And this is a politics of austerity versus now the whole question of quantitative easing and borrowing by the European Central Bank, which is being debated by Prodi and others. Now, I'm not an economist, but if you read what economists are saying, that in effect they are saying that the EU still is facing unemployment. It is not out of the 2008 crisis, which we have sort of not come out of perfectly, but you know, seem to be emerging out of. And there is great disagreement within the EU economic policy maker about which way to go. I mean, the whole drama of the summer was with Syriza, with Los Indignados, the emergence of a democratic populist wave against this policy of stringency, which to me does not seem to be economically very defensible either. It helps the banks, it doesn't help anybody. Now, all this seems just now so far away, all of a sudden the refugee crisis appears to have displaced completely this big economic question, which I think is also in some ways quite central, because the youth unemployment is major in countries like Italy and Spain. So whether Germany will continue, you know, to infringe upon Greece's sovereignty, I just hope that Schäuble is not going to propose that the European Union auction off Greek islands. Now they have to deal with the fact that Greek islands also have refugees on them. I mean, I don't know. Am I the only one, you know, just to just sort of, you know, my jaw drops as, you know, somebody born sort of, let's say, on the European part of Turkey and who, you know, has loved Europe, studied it. It is unbelievable that there is going to be a Europe without Greece. I mean, what is happening? So I'm just going to control. I mean, the supreme irony. You know, what are people thinking? Where does the name Europe come from? The last I looked, it was not a German proverb. You know. Anyway, so I've, you know, but let this be. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I wanted to go back to your point about cosmopolitan citizenship, Sheila. You said that the EU has not created cosmopolitan citizenship, it's just safeguarded a form of legal identity. And I would say that the EU, if anything, has, the European Commission has done a pretty good job of creating a cosmopolitan citizenship, but member states, some more than others, have pushed back very aggressively. So I think if you look at what's happened with this refugee crisis and look at not only Merkel, but look at Juncker, look at Austria, you know, there has been a remarkable voicing of a sort of cosmopolitan, humanitarian, inclusive sentiment that we hadn't seen in Europe for years. You know, to hear senior European politicians saying, actually, this is not a huge number we're talking about in a continent of, I don't know, 350 million, was not a sentiment that you've heard in the previous, you know, 15, 20 years of the EU. So I wonder whether, rather than making a critique of the EU, it's a question of going back to the idealism of that EU project and saying that maybe this very close union never was robust enough to contain both Viktor Orban and, you know, the kind of post-Nazi Germany that we have today. So whether the critique is a critique of the EU or of kind of, you know, national sovereignty, which is alive and kicking in parts of Europe, is really what I wanted you to address.
Yeah, thank you. I meant it as a critique of some unfulfilled promises of this architecture, you know. That is to say, I mean, at a, even at the level of the Commission, if we want to go into the nitty-gritty and so on, the absence of some kind of common understanding of paths to citizenship and what citizenship really means, right? There is a lot of movement towards equalizing social entitlements and so on at a certain point. All this stopped by way of directive. It remained as directives. It didn't get there. But nevertheless, there was a more, if you wish, cosmopolitan vision there. But if you look at the numbers that each EU country is supposed to have taken in terms of this policy of resettlement that is being completely thrown out the window right now, okay? The last figures that I looked at from something called the European Stability Initiative, which I like a lot, apparently, you know, France was going to take something over, you know, 10,000. Slovenia, Croatia, it may promise something like 500 in terms of numbers. There was some kind of proportionality in terms of populations and numbers of refugees, but these are really incredibly symbolic numbers. They just, you know, somehow, why, you mentioned Austria, why did Austria all of a sudden experience such a change of heart? According again to the European Stability Initiative, only about, at the maximum, they are saying, this particular year, no more than 500 people have been processed and resettled. I mean, you know, all these numbers, I'm sure, are up for contention and debate. I don't generate these numbers. So there are puzzles here, and I'm not dismissing the EU project. I'm trying to exercise an internal critique of it. I personally feel it would be a disaster, not just for the EU, but for world political consciousness at large, if this experiment fails. It's an important institution. It's, if I may use the old-fashioned word, a progress of some sorts in human history. No more war, obligations, you know, to international human rights, transnational. I'm all for that. I am not a cynic at all about the EU. about the EU, and I really do worry. And so it's more a critique from the inside. It's an internal critique rather than a dismissal. Is it Jackie?
Yes.
Hello.
Johnny, go ahead. And if everybody else who would like to ask a question could please raise their hands and keep them up so I can note down, that would be great.
Shayla, sorry, thanks very much. Deep pessimism, but I wonder whether you're not pessimistic enough. two thoughts, one connected specifically with the European Union, the other more broadly about the ongoing clash between sovereignty and human rights. So as far as the European Union is concerned, it seems to me that at about the same time, sometime in the middle of the 90s, at the high point of European optimism, three ships were launched on a wish and a prayer. They were the three ships that go to the heart of sovereignty. So borders, Schengen, money, the euro, and defense, which we were going to pool and share and get right. And all three are in deep crisis at the same time. These are the three that go to the heart of sovereignty, and I think that's significant as far as the European Union is concerned, because Schengen has gone into reverse. That's the first time anything that the EU has ever done has gone into reverse. We haven't solved the money thing yet, and from my perspective, the defense project is pretty much defunct. We are now even more reliant on NATO than ever before. So we have a really serious crisis there. It is a crisis of sovereignty as opposed to non-sovereignty or something, cosmopolitanism, whatever. But if you take it to the broader world picture and think about humanitarian intervention, which we experimented with a lot in the 90s, and everybody thought when we first started doing this in Kurdistan and Somalia and so on and so forth, it was simple. You just go in there with troops and you sort them out and you do safe havens or whatever. The experience is that it's not only extremely complicated, but we're doing it very badly and we're actually making things worse. With the result that after Rwanda and Kosovo, we get R2P, we get a significant attempt to enshrine in a document which is then, you know, signed by everybody in the United Nations. And since R2P, we have hardly seen a single implementation of it. Indeed, it's going backwards. We didn't want to do Libya. We've not done Syria. We've not done any of these things. It seems to me that the net effect of these two crises is that sovereignty is being strengthened all the time, and the rights of individuals are actually being weakened all the time in both of those instances. I just wonder whether I'm even more pessimistic than you.
Thanks, Julia. No, it's not a question of pessimism or optimism so much as how does one assess these trends. Despite the symbolic closure of Schengen, I don't think those economies have a prayer of survival without continuing to be integrated into the common market.
I agree.
Yeah. So there is symbolic closure. And this is also a major issue within the Brexit context. My understanding of the situation with the Brexit is that not only would you end up having Scotland, who would wish to remain within the EU so as to precipitate one more time the political crisis, but in terms of economic advantage and interests of the elites, there's in fact major financial institutions that are saying we want to stay in the union because they have frankly greatly benefited. But that does not mean that one can convince the UK population also as a result of a lot of this right-wing populism, which is also growing there, and this kind of symbolic struggle against the European Union Charter of Rights and Freedoms. So say everything originates with Magna Carta. We had it first. This is just a little bit of a variation. There is a confusion there. Now, I didn't want to say anything about the Ukraine because it just seems this so easily becomes an ideological question. And I'm not really an IR person. I don't want to go there, but I do have some opinions as a cosmopolitan citizen. I think that there really is a struggle about two visions of the future of the nation state in Europe. I'm firmly convinced from a lot I have read that Putin believes that the nation state is the end of history. He does not buy any of this post-nationalism, post-sovereigntist stuff. And apparently he has advisors. There's a philosophically very interesting guy whose name I will forget who is feeding him a brew of Hegel, poor Hegel and Carl Schmitt. No, Putin is going to study groups and so on and so forth, you know. So there is a firm belief there that somehow the EU, a kind of post-national vision, is just simply an ideological mistake that needs to be resisted. So that is remaining. I mean, after all, you know, the Ukraine crisis is about Ukraine, you know, saying we want to join, you know, the European social democracy. We consider ourselves a part of this. The attraction of the EU, despite all its problems, is also a kind of puzzling phenomenon. Also for the Syrian refugees who think they are going to the land of, you know, gold and whatever, honey, milk and honey or something. So in terms of the defense issue, there is this very serious clash, I think, of worldviews that is taking place right now, and ergo NATO comes back into the picture. Europeans do not have a common defense independently of NATO, and the danger that we run right now is whether there could be some kind of an inadvertent confrontation or engagement. I mean, the fact that there was the inadvertent drowning of a Russian plane by Turkey on the one hand, and that Turkish and U.S. planes American planes are supposed to be signaling one another. But it's a very tricky situation, isn't it? I mean, you know, at any one point in time, I mean, right there, you know, around Damascus and so on, something can happen. So I think we have to, you know, be very, very intent on trying to avoid that while also not being naive about the fact that that there is a serious clash there. It's not a new Cold War. I don't want to call it that. But it is a serious, you know, clash of vision. In this context, members of the European Union have no choice but to try to exercise solidarity. And of course, as we know, Putin is doing his best to support Jean-Marie Le Pen, UKIP, and other parties.
And Donald Trump.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not, you know, I don't, I mean, I just almost feel reluctant to bring up this language that sounds so much like the language of, you know, sort of anti-communism, but it isn't. It is the realpolitik of our time that is, you know, that is also framing that. So I don't know. I guess I'm agreeing with you. The last point about the R2P. Yes. Humanitarian reason, as Didier Fassin would know, you know, he worked with Médecins Sans Frontières over 10 years, is very difficult, but also in some ways, you know, sometimes almost unavoidable. I think that there could have been other things that could have been done in the context of Syria, and even today, there can be a safe zone on both sides of the border that's necessary for all these refugees now that are coming out of, you know, the bombing of Aleppo and so on. I mean, yes, it's going to be another Kilis, and the Turkish government wants a safe zone across from Kilis. They don't want everyone to come. But, you know, as much as I only have contempt right now for Erdogan, I will give one thing to the Turkish government. They have been amazing in their humanitarianism. 2.2 million people, you know, 2 million. You know, so no solutions.
Hi. I'm Yasir Gökçe from Turkey. Thank you for these good words.
Don't quote me about Erdogan, but you know, I'm on record anyway. I just hope to be able to go back in May.
Turkey has pursued an open door policy vis-à-vis Syria and meticulously observed the principle of non-refoulement, and the number of refugees has reached 2.2 million. And has spent almost $10 billion for the refugees. And I think Turkish government is also aware that these refugees are here, are there to stay, and having that in mind, granted access to health, to education, to labor market. What do you recommend to Turkish government to better integrate these refugees into the society?
Well, there is a problem about access to labor markets and education. From what I can gather, it is all completely haphazard. Health may be better. Labor market access, it's just the black market. It's dependent upon the employer. There doesn't, right now, I think, slowly, a process of work permits is beginning to be instituted. Schooling seems to be still a bit of a mess. In the refugee camps, there are schools. Because the refugee camps are also protected by the UNHCR. Outside the camps, I am honestly not sure what is happening, and I don't know if there is an official policy. It's one of the questions that the German government in particular keeps bringing up, that there are more than 500,000 children who are not receiving schooling at the present. Now, why Turkey would assume that? As you know, I think Mr. Erdogan made one fundamental mistake, among many others, thinking that he could control ISIS. And that because ISIS are Sunni fighters, as opposed to Assad and so on, Turkey got involved in some kind of foreign policy adventurism, the likes of which are really quite unknown in recent history. And this is now coming to haunt the country. Because as Turkey pivots away from the support of ISIS, under the pressure of the United States, etc., there's probably going to be more terrorism within Turkey itself. You know, they are paying back. So this is a very difficult situation, whether these refugees are there to stay. Well, you know, from a human perspective, it makes sense. No, it's the same religion, people who have geographic and ethnic proximity to one another on both sides of the border. There are families, cousins, and so on, right? It makes more sense that, you know, it's the Ottoman Empire in some very strange way, again, that is sort of, you know, reconstituting itself. But the danger is also that the sort of, you know, Syrian population becomes sort of manipulable for foreign policy goals of the government, you know. That is the murkiness that I see. Plus, the fact that whereas a lot of refugees want to stay in Turkey, there are significant numbers that still want to go to Europe.
Jeff.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a difficult question. Since you've tried to put together a bunch of dilemmas that integrate theoretical and normative dilemmas with practical ones, this is one, I guess I would sort of like if you could clarify where you think the logic of your argument leads. Your point is that there is a tension between the notion that individuals all have human rights just as human beings, but that doesn't mean anything unless they have the ability to get them recognized and acted on. And in particular, if people are expelled from or have to flee from their own countries, to say that they abstractly have a right to leave is one thing. To say that they abstractly then have a right to be taken in somewhere else doesn't help unless they can actually get into some place. So that conflicts with the notion that any kind of sovereign entity, whether it's a nation state or some kind of new polity, has the right to control who enters. Because if those units have the right to control who enters and doesn't have to accept everyone, that means that concretely you don't necessarily have a right to be there. The next point is perhaps under certain circumstances, there is a principle that polities may have a right not to admit ordinary migrants, but have an obligation to admit refugees. As you pointed out, in practice, when there are a lot of refugees, that breaks down. It can't be done. That would lead to the next thing. Perhaps polities have an obligation to accept people and give them a safe place, but not necessarily to accept them as members of the political community. Perhaps they don't have that obligation absolutely in every case. But then that just leaves them in limbo. So I guess what I'm asking is, given that there are all these fundamental contradictions and incoherences, is the logic of your argument that in principle, political entities, whether they're nation states or new kinds of entities like the EU, should not, in principle, have the right to control who enters and who becomes a member of the political community, that every individual should have an unconstrained right to travel wherever they want to or think they need to and to be accepted as a member of the community? And if one doesn't take it to that logical conclusion, where, both theoretically and in practice, do you see the possibility of drawing a line up to which they should have those rights, beyond which political entities and political communities would still have some right to select who can enter and who can become a member? Simple question.
No, it's not a simple question. It's a trick question. I know Michael Walzer's fears of justice. This was also the dilemma that, you know, Rawls faced in the Law of Peoples. You know, a nation has a right to limit immigration, but I shall not stipulate the conditions under which this can be done. Footnote, see Michael Walzer's fears of justice, right? These are difficult issues, Jeff, but it is not the logic of my argument alone. It is the internal contradictions of a system of institutions we have created. Thinker who looks at the logic of these institutions, I've taken myself some positions on this. From a moral point of view, the only defensible position are open borders. Yeah? No child is condemned to the moral fate that being born on one side of the border or another does. This is the moral point of view. But you have to mediate the moral point of view with the question of the boundaries of the demos, because there is also some value to the boundaries of the demos. I do believe in self-determination. I do believe that individual groups of individuals have the right to determine the conditions under which they want to conduct their lives collectively. However, none of those conditions are unlimited. In the last 200 years or so, we have developed constitutions, bills of rights, stipulations. There is no absolute right to self-government. I don't believe in that. Okay? So the right to self-government always needs to be mediated, balanced with both, from my point of view, admittedly a universalistic moral consideration, and also in terms of, you know, the commitments of states. So the way I've theorized this in my own work is the self-constitution of the demos. And this is what we are in the midst of now. All debates about immigration, asylum, refugee policy, although they just seem to be sort of in some ways also arcana, technical and so on, it is about the self-conceptualization of a polity. And we haven't even talked about, you know, the United States here, which is a very paradoxical polity, because on the one hand we say we are a country of immigrants, and on the other hand we have engaged in, you know, more deportations. I mean, Jacqueline's work on children separated from their parents and so on has shown that, than, you know, many other countries in the world. And along the Texas borders, there are detention camps still for mothers and children. So put this into our paradoxical self-understanding. On the one hand, a country of immigrants, and on the other hand, the fact that we still treat even mothers and children as criminals and put them into basically prison-like structures. How does then one deal with this? If you accept, as I do, both the principle that from a moral point of view, borders are accidental, but yet also if you accept some right of self-determination duly adjusted for, you know, liberal democratic principles, then I think you end up with a formula of porous borders. And porous borders are going to be inherently, probably, somewhat messy. Okay? And here, in porous borders, we begin with the fundamental obligations that, you know, we have recognized. Asylum, I think, is both a moral and a legal obligation, because the intuition behind the right of asylum is that you have to assume that under certain conditions that you could be the refugee. Yeah? That this could be you. It's very hard for human beings to exercise that moral point of view, that enlarged mentality. But even, you know, as we know, the Bible had, you know, cities of refuge, because it could happen. It could happen to me as well. So I think if we then accept, you know, some of these theoretical premises, I think the kind of position that I have tried to develop is more expansive than Rawls's position in the Law of Peoples, and it is in disagreement with Rawls's position in the spheres of justice, who thinks that who we accept is basically simply a matter of self-determination. But then he says, once individuals are accepted, we are under an obligation to set them on the path to citizenship, because permanent alienage is not permitted. This is the argument, right? I think we have more extensive obligations than that. And also there are matters of, you know, it's not just obligation, it is self-interest also properly considered, that immigration, porous borders also benefit the world, the individuals, that's not an irrelevant argument at all. It is a very complicated question.
I think basically, no. I think essentially, it seems to me, that restates the dilemma and basically says there's no clear and entirely consistent solution to it. So that's really what I wanted to ask. So
yeah.
We're back with the same dilemma.
I'll take that, because I think that all, you know, attempts at a clear solution are not very good either.
Right.
Thank you for raising these important issues. Isn't one of the key distinctions that's being neglected that when it comes to the realm of moral responsibility, I fully agree that you did a wonderful job of showing us this morass of legal norms and moral norms that seem to contradict each other, and that a lot of these distinctions are obsolete. The distinction between refugee and economic migrant is really being pushed to the limit. The distinction between IDP and refugee is being pushed to the limit, because what does it mean for someone who escapes the Islamic State and moves to the Kurdish area of Iraq? He's not a refugee. Or someone who moves from one part of Congo to the other. Or for someone who moves from one part of Libya to another, he's not a refugee. These are, you know, what's the internal unit in IDP? But what do we replace these with? And my question is, would you agree that one of the key criteria in thinking of a replacement is the difference between countries which are actively contributing to the refugee crisis through their foreign policy and the countries that are not? In other words, some countries are through bombing Libya for 6 months, through economic strangulation of certain countries in the Middle East, through arming the al-Nusra Front or what have you, actively and effectively causing an increase in the refugee flow. Other countries are not doing that. And it seems to me that there's a kind of cheap Euro-moralism to say, like, of course Orban is awful, and of course it's awful that Macedonia is pepper spraying, throwing tear gas at children, and that Slovenia is awful, and all of these countries are awful. But the difference is that Hungary and Slovenia and so on did not do what, say, Britain and France did in actively really demolishing the countries that are pushing. You know, when people talk about push factors, they caused, in many ways, the push factors.
Colin Powell once said something very wise, which I'm sure you may know, is the pottery barn principle. You break it, you own it. All right. I mean, and world politics has not been conducted according to that principle. It was his reason for not going into Baghdad the first time around. I actually believe that what we need is a generalized global response. I've been thinking this through a little bit. I think something like this was being suggested by Ignatieff as well. Obviously, Canada has had an extremely successful resettlement and absorption of refugees. Although, might you say that, you know, is it because of its military involvement, whatever? No, Canada recognized this. There's family unification aspect of it as well. Suppose, in effect, that there is a global effort that you say every country in the world where there is, in the first place, a family member can raise a claim to bring in a certain number of kin from these countries affected. This gets very technical. Apply the Guadalajara principle, escaping generalized conditions of violence. The United States has to do much more. If that's what you want me to say, I completely agree with you. The current policy is, shameful. But it is also the case, for example, that there are a significant number of Syrians in Latin American countries who might be very happy to sponsor, their kin people. What about Australia, which has developed a very regressive migration policy. So I'm agreeing with you that the causes of the refugee crises are also certain foreign policy decisions. Therefore, the responses should be more general. And it is not just, you know, EU. I agree that it can't just be EU moralism. And I mean, I think that it would be terrible to see, you know, Angela Merkel, you know, lose increasingly political capital and influence unless, you know, also the Obama administration comes in some fashion or form to her defense. I've never liked that much her politics now, but I think she's absolutely right. She's the only statesperson that I can see around in this crisis.
We're running out of time, but so if we could have Jacob and then Zeynep
start grouping some questions.
Oh, okay.
Let's see if we can get a few more.
Right, and I'll try.
And then other people who just raised their hands, please keep them up and we'll try to.
Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna sort of take a retreat into the theoretical. I want to ask about jurist generativity, and I sort of understand. I can wrap my mind around it on the level of the Constitution. It makes a lot of sense to me. The relation, the bridging between facticity and validity, when you have the sort of the memory of the generation is always there with you in the Constitution. It's very hard to reverse it. But what we're looking at in the EU is the process of reversal. And so I want to ask, can we say that jurist generativity is actually the same phenomenon on the level of transnational law if it can be reversed? If you have the threat of Britain leaving when it doesn't like a principle, and it's not clear to me that the principle then sticks around to sort of provide a normative reminder once the act of rejection has been taken. And the act of rejection, as we're seeing, seems to be much easier in the context of the EU, maybe in the context of international law in general, than it is in the context of a democratic constitution.
Mm-hmm. Let's take two questions at a time right now so we get through everyone.
I was very intrigued by a phrase you used at the very end of your talk. You said, refugees can militantly enact the right to have rights. I was curious, first of all, just simply, what would it look like to enact the right to have rights in this situation? And also, you draw on thinkers like Rensselaer and Agamben, who have written a lot about how the rightless can agitate for their rights, who can engage in disruptive radical action to claim their rights and that sort of thing. So I was wondering if that kind of thinking has any meaning in this context where it's not clear who the audience, or at least let's say the audience is humanity with Arendt. What would it mean to agitate humanity for rights? What kinds of actions are possible, if any? Where do you go, and what kinds of things can you hope for? So I was wondering if this kind of bottom-up action, given these thinkers' great interest in theorization of that concept, has any applicability in the case of asylum seekers.
Yeah,
if
you okay. Want.
Tackle those quickly.
Yes, sure. Jacob, what you are saying is that a constitution still has maybe that jurisgenerative capacity because of the fiction or fact of we the people. It's the higher law that we give to ourselves. And for you, this seems plausible. And you are saying why, you know, assume that kind of we the people moment is at all relevant for, you know, transnational law and so on. I want to say, this is a brief answer, I want to say that actually behind a lot of the major international human rights covenants, there is a jurisgenerative moment. I can't claim this, you know, for transnational commercial law and so on, or administrative law, which is now a hot, hot area that is being worked on by international lawyers, but I would want to make a similar argument in the case of these human rights documents. And one way in which it could be made sometimes is by looking at the process of negotiation of the delegates in their formulations. And I really recommend a book that has completely gone by the wayside, Johannes Morsink, this very detailed analysis of the discussion around every article of the UDHR. I also think it's a wonderful example in some ways of overlapping consensus at work. Yeah? So I hear the question. Now, there are instances of this that are happening. You might say that the storming of the fence in Macedonia is simply an act of lawlessness. You might say that that is an act of anger and defiance that should make us stop and take note. Right? In all the discussion about the Second World War and the camps, one question always kept coming back. The situation is not analogous, but one question always kept coming back. Could one have resisted? Yeah? So I can give you other examples. Syrian refugees, when the Croatian guards wanted to stamp numbers on their arms with indelible ink, said no. They refused. What were they thinking? That's an act of resistance. Other examples have been compiled. There's going to be a wonderful book by Itamar Mann, an Israeli scholar who was at the law school. The book is going to come out soon, called Refugees at Sea, the Universal Boat People, where he gives examples of refugees encountering Australian ships, and you know, they're in frigates and so on, and they're being asked to be taken onto the ship, and there are all sorts of issues. Is the ship to be considered territorial, access to the territory once you are embarked or not? They come with the refugee convention printed and shake them, you know, under the noses of the captains and say, you have a universal obligation. Itamar has just like some wonderful examples like that. These are examples of the enactment of rights, because we are now living in a world where refugees and asylum also know their rights. So that's why it's becoming such an interesting, even if insoluble, even if the big picture is becoming more complicated, as Jeff reminded us.
Okay, so we have the last two questions.
A very simple question. What do you make of the argument put forth now that certain states' troop commitments, for instance, in Afghanistan, or monetary commitments in creating a security in regions producing refugees, like Afghanistan, obviates the need, or fulfills the humanitarian moral obligation and obviates the need for those states to accept refugees. This is sort of the reason that this is the argument put forth to not accept Afghani refugee claims, sort of the opposite of the pottery barn principle. If you're trying to put it together, you don't have to take it home with you.
Thank you. This was very enlightening. Time is short, and just the last point is also very important. I wanted to just raise an issue following up on what you said. We should evacuate them by ship or whatever means, planes. And if we look at looking ahead by Europe's back to the future, we have had two major situations, such as the temporary protection for the Bosniaks, 92, when Ogata, and I worked for 30 years in UNHCR, and I was in Brussels at that time, said, let them come in and we'll help later to see that they can go back as soon as they can. That's what Angela Merkel now is saying. And the other situation was 2000, when the Kosovo bombarding was going on, and we had more than 1 million humanitarian evacuation. It's basically going in line what you said. Of course, the international solidarity is not anymore what it was, and the responsibility then towards now is quite divided. But one could look at those kind of precedents. Of course, there are very difficult dilemmas in the process, but the normal, the infrastructure of laws and institutions, both regional, international, and national, could get help in this way. And I wonder whether you could imagine that one just says Europe should go back to the future.
And then just one more quick, the last question, very briefly.
Very briefly. To what extent do you think that the severity of the European conflict with the refugees as well as internal conflicts among the members of the European Union is due to the fact that the European Union as an entity or a polity has failed to create citizens. It has continued to create Germans, French, Italians, Greeks, and so forth.
These are all wonderful, wonderful questions, and with the start, I mean, Jacqueline Baba said, and she's a distinguished scholar of these issues, of course, she said, it's not the European project as such, but it's the nations that have won more time. I am not, to me, among the younger generation of Europeans, according to all Eurobarometer and other kind of anecdotal experience in terms of people biographies and histories, multi-language, there is a different kind of, you know, consciousness, and I think that generational divides here are really making a big difference. But what's also clear is that in view of the economic crisis, in view of the push by the Islamic State to destabilize European Muslim communities, and not only that, there is a hunkering down and a regression, you know, right now, you know, back to the nationalist alternative. So I'll just say this. Thank you for the reminder why you've worked with the UNHCR, you know it. But I have a question, in fact, for you. Do you agree with my assessment that the reason why Mrs. Merkel is not proposing an airlift or the aid of NATO is because she cannot sell it politically?
Yeah. I mean, I have been the whole of last summer and now over the winter holidays in Europe and especially in Germany, there's an angst. And even though Merkel very convincingly sold the project that we manage, we are schaffen es, and it is an enormous amount of voluntary engagement, right, in many fields for many people, which I think has some economic value, and I might submit that it is the economic longer-term interest, even though many people might not yet realize that Syrians might not pay their pensions in a couple of years. It's still very difficult to imagine. But if there is an successful integration, it could be thought of. And these efforts are underway. And, I mean, after all, it's not a poor state. You know, I think the reasonable thinking people are still very much with her. But she is a very daring person in her propos that we can do it. So much is at stake. So there are now proposals in order to look ahead that she might become perhaps now better the UN Secretary General, coming from the East and having that baggage, and the Eastern Europeans have their turn now. So that might take some tension out of it so that she can finish her term. But I don't see evacuation. That would even create more terms. Though in the night of the 31st of December in Cologne, it's now proven it was only three people who had refugee-like identity who were involved in the so-called abuses and assaults. And I think we have to continue being very careful that whatever is criticized, that it is not associated with people in need of protection.
That's
Let's
right.
put
I
it
mean,
this
the,
way.
The majority, the background of the majority of the people were Tunisian and Moroccans who had been in Germany for a longer period of time, and there was only, you know, a recent Syrian refugee. You know, thanks for the. To come back to the last question, is there a trade-off between the kind of economic help that you give and then the obligation to accept asylum seekers and so on? If we talk about the United States has abdicated moral leadership in this question. And but it doesn't work without it. I mean, I know I'm speaking the language of, you know, my IR colleagues, you know, I said internationally. I mean, power hates a vacuum. If the United States does not exercise leadership, at least symbolically even, in the Syria, you know, crisis, we are seeing the way in which it is spiraling out of control and has consequences for one of US's best allies. So rebuild the countries, of course, and there is no substitute for establishing peace, cessation of hostilities, and rebuilding the countries. I don't think anybody, you know, wants to be a refugee. I think we just have to accept that you know, human beings just, you know, don't pack up. A lot of us in this room do, but because we are ambitious cosmopolitans, we came for professional grounds, for grounds of study and so on. But we know that we have some place that we can go to or that we call home. So these are not just either ors, and there are some, you know, moral common sense things that we have to remember about this situation. But I also think, regardless of the sacrifice that the United States, or notwithstanding the sacrifice that the United States has exercised and the messes that it has created, this is not a question of moral leadership, you know. And it's not as if, you know, there is no U.S. Refugee settlement program. We had some discussions, you know, at Yale with, you know, people from the community who are working with this. It takes 2 years for the United States refugee process, and they go to the camps, and, you know, after 2 years, people are admitted. But it's too little too slow to, you know, give, you know, at least Europe a sense of relief, saying, you know, you're not alone. I mean, maybe what the U.S. has to do and say right now, okay, we're going to put in $20 billion. How about if you put in 30 or something like that?
On that note, thank you very much.